That's it. We're about to go out with a bang. Y'all ready?
Good morning, saints. As we shine a deserving spotlight on the youth of Bailey Tabernacle, please join me in our call to worship. We come to you, O God, to thank you for what is good. We come to you, O God, to cry out for what is wrong. We come to you, O God, to ask for help and restoration. We come to you, O God, with aching hearts and glad souls. Let us worship God. Amen. Today our praise song is intentional. It begins, all things are working for my good, cause it's intentional. Never failing, I know that all things are working for my good. He's intentional, never failing. So please join me in our praise song, Intentional. Amen.
Heavenly Father, thank you for waking us up this morning and blessing us many times. We praise you for being our healer, protector, and provider, and for everything good that has come from your hands. As we have entered a new month, guide us as we don't know what might come. As we live in a time where the country is being consumed by a virus, we pray to you asking to keep us safe and heal the sick and shut in from every sickness, disease, and illness. And teach us to pray as you taught your disciples. Amen.
I will be reading Exodus chapter 15, verses 22 through 27. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord shewed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statute and ordinance, and there he proved them, and said, "If thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee." And they came to Elim, where were 12 wells of water, and 70 palm trees. And they encamped there by the waters. Thank you.
Come on.
In the affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, Bailey family and friends. I'm Louise Lewis, and I've been asked to give the financial appeal for our annual sacrificial feast. Next Sunday, November 15, we will celebrate the annual sacrificial feast, one of our most anticipated programs here at Bailey. Due to COVID-19 safety precautions, this year's celebration will be held virtually. The format will be different, but you can still expect an uplifting and joyful experience. You will still have the opportunity to make your annual sacrificial gift of $500. Pastor Graves and our officers want you to know that each sacrifice is appreciated and each gift is greatly needed at this time. Why? Because the physical doors of our sanctuary may be closed, but the necessary work continues. The need for Bailey's mission is at an all-time high. Praise God, we have learned new ways to share the gospel and safely serve the needs of our community at large. COVID-19 has created hardships and hopelessness for many individuals and organizations, and they are seeking help from churches like Bailey in record numbers. Collectively, our sacrificial gifts will be a stimulus to Bailey's desire to do more for those who are hurting spiritually, economically, physically, and in so many other ways. After all, we are the body of Christ. My motivation to sacrifice beyond my tithes and offering is driven by these five facts. Number one, God's sacrificial love. Number two, I am motivated to sacrifice because of God's word. Number three, I am motivated to sacrifice because of God's grace. His amazing grace. I am also motivated to sacrifice because of God's mercy. And because God has shown so much mercy to me and to you, finally, I am motivated to sacrifice because of my own growing faith. And I know that faith without works is dead. You may use several methods to make your sacrificial gift. From your computer or phone, use PayPal. PayPal.me/Bailey Tabernacle CME Church. From your computer or phone, use the Givelify app and select Bailey Tabernacle CME Church. Or you can also mail your check or money order to Bailey Tabernacle CME Church, Post Office Box 3145, Tuscaloosa, Alabama 35403. On behalf of Pastor Graves and the men and women who serve as stewards here at Bailey Tabernacle CME Church, thank you so much for your sacrificial gift. May God bless you and keep you safe.
My name is Sanaa Harris, and I'm going to be talking about the first female African-American pilot, Bessie Coleman. Bessie Coleman was born in Atlanta, Texas, where there is a lot of poverty, discrimination, and segregation. At 23, she moved to Chicago to pursue her dream of flying after hearing stories of returning World War I soldiers. But she faced double stigma by being a woman and African American. So she learned French, so in 1919 she could move to France to become a pilot. In 1921 of June, she learned to fly and got her license. She returned to the U.S. to perform many air shows and also encouraged other African Americans to pursue their flying career.
Thank you.
with me. Pray for me. Come, Holy Spirit, and settle our hearts and minds to receive a word from you. Use me as a preacher in this moment, that every word of my mouth, every meditation of my heart, you would set acceptably in your sight, but allow me, Father, to step back out of the way, to set my focus and our focus completely on Jesus, in whose name and for whose sake we pray. Amen. We are continuing in our series, the book of Exodus, and we begin today where we left off, on the far shore of the Red Sea. On the far shore of the Red Sea, Pharaoh was dead. His army was destroyed. Egypt, the nation that had held the Israelites under its heel for centuries, had been so thoroughly devastated by plagues that they didn't make another move against Israel until after the reign of King Solomon, more than 500 years later. So there was no more looking over their shoulders for Pharaoh's chariots to come running them down. Old Master was dead and nobody was coming to take them back to the plantation. For the first time in four generations, the Hebrew people were free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last. In the first portion of Exodus chapter 15, Moses and Miriam sang and praised the Lord. And I can't imagine that this would have been the only song that the newly emancipated slaves had sung. Surely they would have danced and drummed and rejoiced. They were on their way to the promised land. Hallelujah. And so they walked and they walked and they walked and they walked until the water ran low. And they walked until 3 days out from the Red Sea, the water ran out. And most of these ex-slaves had never been more than a couple of miles away from the village well. They would have wondered, where do you get water in the wilderness? Dry mouthed and dehydrated, they finally come to an oasis. An oasis that has a great spring of water, large enough to quench the thirst of everyone in the company. Once more, the Lord had provided. But Exodus 15:23 says, though the water was there, they could not drink the water because it was bitter. And I don't mean like LaCroix water bitter. I mean this water was polluted. It was contaminated. It was unsafe to drink. What do you do when the means of your deliverance turns out to be another thing trying to hurt you? What do you do when your provision turns out to be poison? How does a people or a person handle such double trouble? And why would God even allow his people to experience this kind of compound calamity? The answers here in the closing verses of Exodus chapter 15 are answers the Lord has ordained for this moment in our journey, and our journey as a people, our journey as a nation, our journey as the people of the kingdom of God. And so the title of this message from the end of Exodus chapter 15 is From Bitter to Better. From Bitter to Better. Exodus 15 verse 22 says, Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. They went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters, for they were bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah. Just 72 hours before this moment, the Israelites had walked across the floor of the Red Sea while God held back the waters as a wall on either side. And now you would think that having recently experienced such an epic water-based miracle, that they would not have been fazed by something as simple as a contaminated spring. You think that they would once more do what they did and cry out to the Lord and look to Moses to share with them what the Lord had answered. But that's not what happened. Just two articles of bad news in succession, and the people reverted back to their pre-Red Sea ways, and they complained. They didn't pray. They didn't seek a word from the Lord. They turned on the prophet and griped. Now, what are we supposed to drink, Moses?
in the church, in a community, in a workplace, in a family, or just in your personal social circle. There are going to be times when your people have a legitimate need, but none of them is actually doing anything about it. And all they do is complain to you. In such situations, you have to be the one who has better spiritual sense. So when they complain, you have to pray. The people complained against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And Moses cried out to the Lord. Moses translated the community's complaints into personal prayer, real prayer. And real prayer is when you talk to God and you listen to God. Moses listened. And in Exodus 15, 25, the Lord showed him a tree. Showed him a tree. And when he cast that tree into the waters were made sweet. Now, depending on the Bible version you're looking at, the Hebrew word here may be translated tree or log or piece of wood. We don't know if this was something that Moses could pick up in one hand and casually toss into the water. Or we don't know if it was something that had to be chopped and sawed and dragged by a team of dehydrated men and animals over to the water and with their last portion of strength pushing it into the spring. In other words, we don't know if the solution that God provided was easy or difficult. The solution to your situation may be simple, or it might be intimidatingly complex. Your situation may be resolved on the cheap, or the solution may be prohibitively expensive. The solution to your dilemma may be positive and affirming of the community's pride, but then again, the solution might be convicting and humbling. The solution may require us to refocus away from reparations for the sins committed against us and direct our energies in repentance for the sins we have committed against ourselves. The Lord has promised to answer the prayers of his people, but he has not promised that his people will always like the answers. Let me say that again. The Lord has promised to answer the prayers of his people, but he has not promised that we will always like the answers he provides. Whether it was a big tree or a small piece of wood, God did show Moses how to fix the problem of the bitter waters. And now I know that here is his place where we want to dive into enjoying the transition, because he cast the tree into the waters and they go from bitter to sweet. But if you hold on a minute, I'll show you something so you don't miss a crucial point. Because scripture says that the Lord showed the tree to Moses. And the word translated showed is the root of the Jewish term Torah, which means teachings. God didn't simply point at a tree. God didn't just shine a light on a random tree out in the wilderness, but the Lord taught Moses what to look for. God instructed Moses in how to identify and apply a corrective approach to the process of purifying poison provision. God worked with Moses so that he would understand what he was seeking in order to transfer bitter into sweet. This schooling by revelation was necessary because the tree wasn't a new addition. The tree was not miraculously provided. The tree had been there from the beginning. The children of Israel had walked past the tree on their way to the waters they were complaining about. At the oasis, as in life, every problem already has a solution. Every question already has an answer. The problem is we don't know which answer is the answer. The Bible does not say my people are destroyed because they have difficulties. But in Hosea 4:6, the Bible says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. The problem isn't the problem. The lack of knowing the solution is the problem. Which is why when we have our little talks with Jesus, we have to do more than just tell him all about our troubles. He will answer by and by, but if we aren't listening, we'll miss his answer. We have to listen to what the Lord is teaching us. We have to pay attention to what God is showing us. We have to hear, really hear what God has to say, even if what God has to say isn't something we want to hear. God did not strike the waters at Marah with a mighty east wind and blow all the contaminants away. But the Lord taught Moses what to look for. If Moses had waited for God to directly fix the problem with another spectacular water-based miracle, instead of paying attention to the still small voice of the Spirit, then Moses' people would have died at the waters of Marah. The Gospel of John, chapter 5, tells the story of a man who had been paralyzed for 38 years. There was a pool of water by the sheep gate in Jerusalem, and every now and then an angel would come down and stir the waters of the pool. Whomever got into the waters first was cured of whatever was wrong with him. And this man had been coming to this pool for a long time, maybe coming all 38 years of his paralysis, but he had never been able to get to the pool first after the angel came down. The waters would move and the crowd would stir and he would drag himself with all his strength, but someone always got there first. Then one day, Jesus stopped by. And in John chapter 5, verse 6, it says, when Jesus saw the man lying there, knew that he had already been in that condition for a long time, Jesus said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" Jesus spoke to his situation. The Lord came to him, delving into the true desires of his heart, and the man responded by complaining. In John 5, 7, he complained that it wasn't his fault. Nobody would help him. The other sick folk were always jumping ahead of him, and Jesus hadn't even asked him any of those questions. He hadn't asked why the man hadn't been at the front of the line. Jesus didn't ask what had gone wrong in his past attempts. Jesus had asked, "Do you want to be made well?" But the man hadn't been listening. He hadn't been listening to what the Lord said. He'd been listening for what he assumed the Lord would say. But Jesus didn't handle this as anyone would have scripted. Jesus didn't transfigure and wrap the paralyzed man in the divine glow of Shekinah glory. Jesus didn't lay his hands on the man and loudly declare and decree healing. Jesus didn't even say, "You are made whole." Jesus simply said in John 5:8, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And as verse 13 says, he then quietly withdrew to avoid drawing attention from the crowd. Jesus said it and left. That man could have stayed there on the ground, could have continued watching the water, could have kept on what had become a 38-year tradition of waiting for the angel. Instead, he finally listened and obeyed what God told him. And immediately, he was made well, took up his bed, and walked. Some of you have been sitting around marinating in your pain, waiting on an angel to descend from heaven and stir the waters and make it all better. And it hasn't happened. You see other people getting their miracle and you complain to the Lord. "Why can't I get what they got, Lord? Why are they blessed but I ain't, Lord? Whatever you doing for them, don't do it without me, Lord." And all these years, the Lord has been speaking into your situation. All these years, the Lord has been trying to tell you something, but you ain't listening. The Lord is speaking to you, trying to get you to refocus on the truth on the inside of you. but you're so stuck on your solution being some grand miracle like those folks' miracle. So stuck on what you assume that the Lord is going to say that you aren't hearing what Jesus is saying. You aren't learning what the Holy Spirit is trying to teach you. God has planted the solution right there, right next to where the problem is. But you're so obsessed with this imaginary image of how your blessing has to come that you're missing the still small voice of God saying, go on, just rise up and walk. Go on. This is the kind of tree you're going to look for. In Exodus 15, Moses listened. And Moses applied what the Lord taught him. He located the content his people needed to transform that bitter situation into a sweet one. And all the people drank the sweet waters and were refreshed. And we don't know exactly how long Israel stayed there, camped at Marah. But we do know that it was long enough for them all to learn something new. Because Exodus 15:25 said that there the Lord made a statute and an ordinance for them. A statute and an ordinance means principles and practices. God gave them a principle to live by and a set of behaviors for applying that principle. And that lesson was followed by a test. There he made a statute and an ordinance for them, and there he tested them. Scripture, again, doesn't provide specifics, but we know the rest of the Bible, from the rest of the Bible, that God tests us by creating or allowing difficult situations in which obeying God ceases to be convenient, stops being easy, and is no longer immediately profitable. Obeying God is always best for us in the long run, but in the short term, sometimes following the Lord can cost you. So maybe these new rules at Marah meant giving up something the Israelites had enjoyed before, and they were tempted to reach back for that pleasure. Maybe new troubles came up and following the word of God started to cost them money or time or power. Maybe obeying God's statute and ordinance turned out to be more work than they thought at first. Maybe with no Pharaoh to worry about and a new supply of fresh water, the people started questioning if they still even needed to follow these old religious teachings. Or maybe the waters went bitter again and there were no more water purifying trees to use. We don't know, but we know they were tested. And we know they passed. We know they passed because the consequence of failure, according to Exodus 15, verse 26, would have been to be subjected to the plagues that had decimated Egypt. And we know that Israel left Marah unplagued, meaning they passed the test. They'd come in complaining, but they left confirmed in faith. Their experience had begun in bitterness, but by faith, it turned out to be better. But better not because of what God did in the water. Better because of what God did in the hearts of the people. Unconsciously, we tend to think of the story of the waters at Marah as a problem that God stepped in after the fact to solve with revelation and a curative piece of wood. But remember that when they came to the bitter waters, God himself was guiding them as a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. So Israel didn't happen upon this location by coincidence. God deliberately brought them to a place where the waters were bitter. And the point of bringing to this place was not to fix the water problem. God could have done that before Israel arrived. The point wasn't for the Lord to show off with another miracle, because God chose not to handle these waters issues in a spectacular fashion. The point of Israel's experience at Marah wasn't the water. The point was the test. And the point of the test was the choice. The choice to follow God only when it's convenient and immediately beneficial. To follow God when your faith is affirmed with immediate benefit and convenient blessings. Or the choice to follow God even when your faith is tested. The choice to follow God when what he asks of you is in line with what you already wanted to do, or the choice to obey the Lord even when his statutes and his ordinances don't fit your personal or political preferences. Mara wasn't about their need for water. It was about their need for faith. The need for faith that had been tested. The need for faith that had been tested and therefore made stronger. Mara wasn't about taking water from bitter to sweet. It was about taking a community's faith from bitter to better. We are recording this message 2 days after the 2020 election. And 2 days later, we still don't know who won. Maybe the racist, sexist, would-be despot was reelected. If so, we're facing some bitter waters ahead. Maybe the co-author of Modern Mass Incarceration and his running mate, the prosecutor, won their first term. If so, before drinking deep of what they offer, we'll want to check the contents carefully, because we might again find that our provision has been poisoned. Whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, the final results of this election will seem to you either bitter or sweet. But it isn't really about the results. This moment's historical experience is really about the choice you make in your faith. You and I can choose to trust and obey God in proportion to how bitter or how sweet we find the results of this election. Or we can choose to trust and obey God, period. We can choose to learn and internalize the principles that are taught in God's word. We can choose to believe it when God shows us the truth about the world and ourselves. We can choose to believe it when God shows us, and one of the truths that God shows us is in this story of the waters at Mara. And it is at this historical moment, like each historical moment, however all-consuming and all-defining it seems to be, it is not. This season, the plague, the election, the unrest, the anxiety, the turmoil you are experiencing in your life, none of this has the final word on your destiny. When the children of Israel arrived at the oasis of Mara, the waters there were not the final word on their thirst. When the waters proved bitter, they despaired that they would all die in bitterness. And when the solution was applied and the waters became sweet, they rejoiced that the newfound sweetness was the final word, but then they were tested. All they could see was the water at Mara. But that one rehabilitated spring wasn't nearly as important as it seemed at the time. You see, the waters at Mara were just a pit stop. And not even the main pit stop. Because Exodus 15 verse 27 says, then they came to Elim. And at Elim, there were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees. So they camped there by those waters. Mara had one spring, but God already had a plan and a path to bring them to a place with 12 times as many sources of refreshment. They were happy at Mara to have one tree they could put in the bitter waters to remove the taint. But God had a plan and a path to lead them to an orchard of 70 trees that would supply them with food for the moment and provision for the road ahead. I know it feels like this present wellspring of history is the only source of our people's survival, but the Lord has a greater oasis already waiting. In eternity, in heaven, and in this life here in America, there are enough springs for all our people to be filled. In eternity, in heaven, and in this life in America, the Lord has already ordained provision for now and provision for the journey ahead. And if we, the people who are called by Jesus' name, will seek and learn and obey the principles, the practices, the statutes and ordinances revealed in God's word, then God will lead us as he led Israel. And we will realize that what comes next is bigger than everything we're experiencing right now. You personally may be facing an uncertain oasis in your personal life. You may be in a relationship that you thought would be sweet, but it has filled your life with lonely bitterness. You may have set your hope on a career path you expected to be professionally and financially refreshing, but those waters turned out to be corrupted and contaminated. You may be struggling against a sin, an addiction, or an affliction of the mind, and you set your hope on a particular remedy. And now, like citizens on election night, you're waiting to see if it turns out bitter or sweet. But God is reminding you that he's got more for you than what you can see in this moment. Maybe this job works out and maybe it doesn't, but God has greater opportunities for your gifts than what you can see right now. Maybe this person you're dating is the one and maybe they're not, but God has greater love waiting for you than even Hallmark can imagine. Maybe this treatment approach fixes it up all right, and maybe it doesn't. But the ultimate fate of your body, your mind, and your soul does not rest in the hands of a therapist, a pharmacist, or a politician. Doesn't even rest in your hands. But John 10:28, Jesus said, I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. Your fate rests in the hands of the Son of God. Your fate and destiny rests in the hands of Jesus Christ. Jesus has the final say, and Jesus has bigger plans for you than just this. Jeremiah 29:11 affirms, the Lord declares, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. As Jesus declares in the Gospel of John 10:10, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. You see, this moment, bitterness, is just a test. Just a test during which God is going to show you how things really work. Just a test during which, if you will listen to the voice of the Lord, he'll give you the principles and the practices to understand what's going on. He'll teach you how to see the solution that he has already ordained for the problem you're in right now. And even when that happens, even when that solution is applied, even when things turn sweet, don't get complacent, because God has a bigger oasis waiting for you. Ephesians 3:20, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. There's a greater oasis for you in heaven forever, and this life yet to be lived. Like Israel before the waters of Marah, you have to choose. You have to choose to build your hope on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. You have to choose to trust the word of God even when it's not the word you would have chosen before. You have to choose to believe and to know that the God who brought you through that Red Sea moment can bring you through this time of bitter waters. You have to choose Jesus, because Jesus is the only one who can take you in this moment of bitter and bring you to the better he has waiting. If you're hearing this and you've never chosen to to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That's a choice you can make right now. You can choose. You can choose to continue in your sin, the guilt, the shame. You continue. You can choose to continue trying to fix it yourself, knowing it hadn't worked that way so far. Or you can choose to receive the free gift that Jesus offers to you. You can choose to be saved. You can surrender your life to Jesus right now. He become your Lord and Savior and deliver you from sin and death. If you're willing to choose Jesus, pray with me. Dear Lord, forgive me. I am a sinner. I make no excuses. I confess to you all the wrong I have done by my actions, by my words, even by my thoughts. And Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me. I confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, God himself coming to the world, and I ask you, Jesus, to be my Lord, to come into my heart and to save my soul. Cleanse me of all my sin and unrighteousness. Write my name in your book of life. Let me live the rest of my life in you and eternity in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. It may be, like the children of Israel, you've been walking the path of God for a while, but you got off somewhere, allowed the complaints or the tests to pull you aside. But you're still here. God is still here. And you can come back to him. You can recommit yourself to the path of Christ. You can rededicate yourself to the work of God. You can return to him, and he'll receive you. If you're willing to come back, if you're willing to let the Lord do what he does, take your bitter and make it better. Pray with me. Lord, I'm sorry for falling away. I'm sorry for failing you, from getting off the path of your purpose for my life. Confess my failings and faults. Now come now, Lord, to rededicate myself to you. Father, please receive me back. Set me back on the path. Use me with everything I am and everything that by your grace I can be. Allow me to walk with you from this moment forward. By grace, by faith, and the strength of your spirit, in complete obedience, I give myself to you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed today, or if you need prayer today, if you need to intercede on behalf of someone, that we can pray for you, we can pray with you, we can be with you in this moment, in this season, however things in the nation turn out, God is still God, and he still loves you. We're here for you. We invite you to find us on our website, baileytabernaclecme.org. In the contact page, you can see our number, our email address. Reach out to us. Connect with us. Let us pray with you. Let us pray for you. Let us be your community of faith. If you will, reach out to us and help us connect with you. You can use the social media platform by which you're receiving this, the comment, the messaging applications. But whatever it is you do, remember that even though the Sunday morning doors of Bailey Tabernacle are closed, the doors of our hearts in this ministry and the doors of God's kingdom are always open for you. God bless you. We love you. Amen.
This time I want y'all to help us do it. Lift your hands in this atmosphere and say, I am grateful. Have done. Look at him and tell him, yes, I'm grateful. The victories that we've won. Tell him I could go on and on. About your works. Because I'm grateful. Praise you, Lord. Lift your hands and say, flowing from my heart.